Thank you, colleagues. I hope we can now move to the next item of business, which is a members' business debate on motion 275 in the name of Paul Sweeney on Our Factory, Our Future, the Fight to Save McVitie's at Tollcross, Glasgow. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. And I would ask those members who wish to speak in this debate to please press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Paul Sweeney to open the debate.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thanks to all colleagues from across the Chamber who supported this motion for debate today. I'd also like to declare an interest as a member of Unite and GMB, both of whom are fighting relentlessly to protect as many jobs as they can. The struggle facing the workers at McVitie's in the East End of Glasgow echoes the struggle of so many skilled industrial workers in Scotland over the last 50 years. From Michelin Tyres in Dundee to the Calais railway workers in Glasgow, it is a grimly familiar story of an overseas owner asset stripping Scotland's industrial base. But like so many other cases, closure is far from inevitable. And indeed, this Parliament, founded in the face of such struggles, has a duty to prevent it going the same way as so many other proud Scottish industries and brands. The workforce is highly dedicated, talented and loyal. They are a workforce rooted in their local community, and they are incredibly proud of the work and the history which extends through generations of families to the foundation of McFarlane and Lang's Bakers in the Gallowgate two centuries ago, building a brand that is famous the world over. They are a credit to their community, and they should be extremely proud of their conduct throughout this period of distressing uncertainty. We saw what the plant and its employment meant to the local community in the immediate aftermath of Pladis's closure announcement in May. They sprang into action, and to date, their petition to save nearly 500 jobs has amassed over 75,000 signatures. To be fair, the Scottish Government are to be commended for at least setting up the action group, which has developed the counter-proposal with Scottish Enterprise and the Interpath Consultancy as an alternative to the end of McVitie's production in Scotland. They engaged with the relevant trade unions and agencies, and they put together a viable and credible alternative. The blame for this closure lies squarely with Turkish-owned multinational Pladis, which took control of McVitie's and the wider United Biscuits group in 2014. However, the Scottish Government have far from exhausted all options at their disposal. Deputy Presiding Officer, Pladis and their parent company, Yildiz Holdings, are a classic example of the unacceptable face of capitalism, loading their acquired companies with debt while extracting profits and running their assets down in a programme of managed decline. I've long argued that Scotland and Britain as a whole must have an industrial strategy which protects homegrown brands from takeovers by asset stripping overseas predators. And the situation at McVitie's in Glasgow is just the latest example that proves exactly why that must now be a priority going forward. As far as I'm concerned, their conduct amounts to industrial vandalism that will inflict misery on a working class community that simply cannot afford it. The East End of Glasgow already has an unemployment rate that is almost double the national average. The latest available figures show that over 5,000 people claim unemployment benefits in the area, and we now face the prospect of another 500 being added to that figure. And it's not just 500 workers in isolation, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's 500 families who now face uncertainty. It's absolutely shameful. While the executives at Pladis were planning to wield the axe at the Tollcross plant, forcing hundreds onto the dole, they enjoyed a record turnover of £2 billion, with profits amounting to £154 million. Is anyone really going to argue that any of that would have been possible without the dedicated and skilled workforce that they are now abandoning? The counter-proposal robustly addresses the company's justification for closing Tollcross, a high cost per tonne and low volume relative to production capacity across the UK. The counter-proposal centres around a purpose-built, state-of-the-art 250,000 square foot factory on government-owned land at nearby Gartcosh, giving Pladis a blueprint to develop a new, highly efficient factory system in the future to replace what is admittedly an aged portfolio of 7 production sites acquired by United Biscuits over the years. The problem? Who is going to pay for it? Deputy Presiding Officer, that is where my praise for the Scottish Government is not quite so forthcoming. Last month, the company rejected the proposal, meaning we are now essentially in a standoff situation. The company want to know who will pay for the counter-proposal, and the Scottish Government want to know that Plaidis are committed to maintaining a presence in Scotland before they will commit to detailed financing arrangements. Deputy Presiding Officer, for as long as that boardroom standoff continues, 500 families are left in the lurch. It's becoming increasingly clear that the company are not going to budge, and that's why I implore the Scottish Government to put their cards on the table and take a lead. Do I think the counter-proposal is credible? Yes, I do. Do I think that the Scottish Government genuinely want to save these jobs? Yes, I do. Do I think they have exhausted all the options available? No, I do not. Last night, the Scottish Government claimed that Plaidis had given no indication that financial assistance and state aid would change their approach. In response, I would like to ask the Cabinet Secretary a simple question. Has the Scottish Government, in negotiations, explicitly said to Plaidis that they would provide the capital funding to build the new factory? If not, why not? Plaidis operates sale and leaseback arrangements for a number of their sites in Chiswick, High Wycombe and Carlisle. Therefore, the assertion that they are not open to this financing structure is unconvincing and doesn't stand up to scrutiny. Frankly, we need more from the Scottish Government. So today, I ask once more, commit to funding this counter-proposal. Let's save these jobs and ensure that we don't add McVitie's to the growing list of brands lost by Scotland's lack of an industrial strategy.
Thank you, Mr Sweeney. I next call John Mason to be followed by Annie Wells.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It is incredibly disappointing that Plaidis is refusing to change its position, which is likely to mean the loss of some 468 jobs in the East End of Glasgow. In some cases, that will mean two or more wage earners in the one family, so the financial implications for some will be huge. I also understand there is criticism of the redundancy packages that have been offered, and I'm sure the GMB and other unions will be pressing Plaidis on this, and I'm sure we will all be wanting to help them if we can. And I certainly trust that Job Centre Plus, Skills Development Scotland and other public agencies will be supporting those who are losing their jobs. I do broadly accept that the biscuit and snack markets are very competitive and there is probably overcapacity. Younger people do not seem to be eating biscuits as much as my generation has done, whereas I have a rich tea or ginger nut or chocolate digestive with my coffee. I do notice that younger staff who work for me tend not to do so. Therefore, it was highly likely that Plaidis would have to close some factories, and I suspect Tollcross may not be the last. So in practice, Tollcross was competing with the other Plaidis plants. I know that the government and the council and the unions did not want to say this, but I do consider it was the reality. If we were to save Tollcross, it would be because another factory in Manchester or Liverpool or Carlisle was to close instead. It has been clear for many years that Tollcross was not being invested in, and so I think most of us have been half expecting closure for a long time. Plaidis had been offered support, if it's brief, yeah?
Daniel Johnson.
Does he not acknowledge that there is any role for the Scottish Government to preemptively or support industry and to reinvest? So perhaps investments could be made in biscuits young people do want to eat.
John Mason.
We'll hear from the government in due course. I do think the government has put, and the council together, with the trades unions, have put a lot of effort into this. I am not aware of more that the government can do, but we will hear in due course, I'm sure, some of the responses to the points that Mr Sweeney made. It's been clear for many years that Tollcross was not being invested in, so I think, as I said, most of us were expecting something like this to happen. Plaidis has been offered support to relocate in Glasgow some years ago, with both Scottish Enterprise and Clyde Gateway involved, and the government and council have strengthened that offer in recent weeks. The galling thing is that all of this has been happening at a time when the Scottish food and drink sector has been doing very well. Even within the biscuit sector, we see Tunnocks, Walkers and Border Biscuits doing well, while Baxter's and Bars have been other success stories. We know that Scottish food produce is high quality and often commands a premium price on world markets, as is the case with salmon and whisky. So one disappointment for me has been that McVitie's have consistently refused to brand their goods from Tollcross as Scottish. I guess that makes it easier to package all their biscuits in the same way, but I do feel they missed a trick in this. Another significant factor has been that McVitie's was not Scottish-owned with a Scottish headquarters. Being a Scottish company does not guarantee that there will be no problems and no closures. We know that other Scottish businesses have had to cut costs and trim staff. But when the HQ is in Scotland, it does mean that there is generally a stronger commitment to continuing here and to supporting the local employees and outside contractors as well. It also means that the jobs here will tend to be higher quality than if a Scottish factory is just one among many branches. So it seems to me that one of the lessons out of this is that we must more strongly resist the takeover of Scottish companies. I accept that will not apply in every case, but I do think it should be our assumption that it is better to keep HQs in Scotland because there are... No, I'm sorry, I don't have time. Because to keep HQs in Scotland unless there's a specific reason otherwise, and that should not just be making the shareholders a fast buck. United Biscuits itself was listed in the Stock Exchange in 1948. Such a listing is sometimes seen as a sign of success, but it is also a sign that control has been lost and the link with the business roots have largely gone. There was an excellent article in the Herald in May this year by Martin Stepek of the Scottish Family Business Association. He argued that we need to look at other ways of succession for family businesses, for example, selling to its employees. I do hope for the best for the employees of McVitie's at Tollcross. If the government can do anything, that is absolutely great, and we are all here to support. But I also hope the government and Scottish Enterprise will take on board the need to try and keep more business headquarters in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. Annie Wells, to be followed by Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I would like to thank Paul Sweeney for bringing this important matter to the Chamber. I am grateful for the opportunity to speak today. It's an issue which will have huge, indeed adverse, consequences for the East End of Glasgow. Like many local residents, I am bitterly disappointed and frustrated over the fashion in which Glasgow's McVitie's factory has been pushed towards closure at the expense of so many jobs. My thoughts first and foremost are with the workers, their families, at this difficult time. I would first like to pay tribute to the efforts made by the many public figures, organisations and individuals across our communities who came together to fight for these jobs. In particular, I would like to say a thank you to Save Our Jobs McVitie's Tollcross, who, due to their sheer determination and campaigning, attracted almost 80,000 signatures to save the factory. Despite the bitterly disappointing outcome, efforts to leave no stone unturned in saving these jobs has been truly remarkable, but yet more can still be done. Yes.
Michelle Thompson. Ms. Thompson, I'm not sure if your microphone is on. Is your card in? Okay, can we try again? Thank you.
I apologise for that. Thank you for giving way. Does the member recognise, however, that the regulation that resides at the City of London, as commented by Paul Sweeney in his speech, has allowed the company to pull money out of it, to have very opaque tax arrangements and so on? And therefore, will she join me in asking the Westminster government to sort this out? Because this is a repeating theme across a number of businesses across the UK.
Annie Wells.
I thank the member for that intervention. What I would say is we're talking about 500 individuals here. I want to concentrate and focus on them right now. I'll happily have a conversation with the member after this debate. I know my colleagues in the Glasgow Conservatives, including Councillor Thomas Kerr, have been campaigning tirelessly alongside Labour and SNP counterparts to champion these workers in the face of Paris's decision. Presiding Officer, it must be said I share the anger that so many people share, that Paris have appeared to be determined to press ahead with the closure of this factory, almost 500 jobs set to be lost. For too long, they have failed to fully support this site, and now this is the final blow to the workforce. The impact this will have on those involved, their families and the local community cannot be understated. Generations of workers in the local area and beyond have helped to bring success to this historic manufacturing institution in Glasgow. More recently, workers have gone the extra mile by continuing to manufacture despite the difficult circumstances arising from the COVID pandemic. To see it close in such a fashion, therefore, is a true blow to the local communities and the whole of Glasgow. To be absolutely clear, it's a slap in the face to a loyal and highly dedicated workforce. Presiding officer, the public health emergency presented by this virus is still sadly unfolding. Yet, given we are facing one of the biggest economic challenges in our lifetime, the pressing need to secure Glasgow's and Scotland's economic recovery has never been more urgent. Many Glaswegians have been forced into financial hardship over the past 18 months, and we are supposed to be looking ahead to a new period of promising economic recovery. That's why, with the loss of these highly valued jobs, it is certainly not the start of the economic recovery from COVID that Glasgow needs. We've also saw major retailer Tesco Extra Parkhead, also in the east end of the city, signal that it may have to downsize potentially, leading to further disruption of jobs and livelihoods in the local area. To be clear, I fully expect the parties involved to explore every avenue in order to help and protect as many jobs as possible. Presiding officer, that ultimately matters now is that those who are faced with the prospect of redundancy get the right support. And I urge the Scottish Government to step up and commit to make this the case. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Wells. I call Richard Leonard to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I refer members to my register of interests? The McVitie's factory means a great deal to me personally, and by the factory, I don't mean the buildings, I mean the people, I mean the workers. For 5 years, working with the GMB, with representatives like Phyllis Riddle, Margaret Boyd, Tommy MacDonald, we organised those workers in battles over skill shortages, understaffing, equal pay, long hours, and yes, capital under investment. Many battles we won, some we lost, but now those workers are facing Armageddon. And so I say to MSPs here this afternoon, it is our duty, the duty of this Parliament, not to walk away and accept defeat, but to stand with them, stand firm and fight with them. Because there is a simple injustice here at the heart of what's going on. The injustice that a company or a factory can be bought and sold and now facing closure with little or no say for the workers and a transnational corporation unwilling to cooperate. The injustice that quality brands, some over 100 years old, built up over decades by generations of workers, can be taken over, assets stripped, those brands robbed in just 2,000 days. This is banditry, nothing less. Now, people say to me that the idea of class is out of date, that class doesn't matter anymore. Well, look at the concentration of wealth and power in the hands of the owners of Plaidis, and look at how little wealth and how little power is in the hands of the workers of Plaidis in Glasgow, and tell me that there is no class system at work. In fact, if ever there was an example of why we so desperately need a different future beyond this kind of corporate, extractive, asset-robbing, bandit capitalism run by an ever-narrowing elite, this is it. What is happening at McVitie's should ring alarm bells to this Parliament and to this government. Alarm bells about our economy's precarious exposure to external ownership, which the present government appears to be at least, at best agnostic about, at worst positively enthusiastic about. Alarm bells about what happens when you separate corporate management and control from so-called mere operations, even though it is the mere operations that maintain the quality of the brand, that makes the money, that lines the pockets of shareholders. And it should ring alarm bells too. Why we urgently need at last a Scottish industrial strategy, a strategy investment-led, jobs first, people-centred, manufacturing-driven, based on democratic economic planning. Because the day must surely come when working women and men like those at McVitie's Tollcross finally have the power to shape their own destiny, when we have an economy
which works in the interests of the many, not the few, where the rights of owners are not absolute, where jobs and livelihoods cannot simply be bought and sold and then sold down the river. On Tuesday, we mark the centenary of the birth of Raymond Williams, who once said, and I quote, "To be truly radical is to make hope possible rather than despair convincing." And that is why this Parliament needs to be awakened this afternoon. Ministers must understand the anger of these workers, because they know that the deck is stacked against them. Ministers must understand that we need concerted action from the new coalition government, not sending in the PACE team, but concerted action, because there is still time to save these jobs, to save this factory, to save these workers. And that is the task that lies before us. That is what we are sent here to do. Because I tell you, I don't just want old memories of the McVitie's factory. I want today's workers and the generations to come to have the new future that they deserve.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I now call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy, and Pam Duncan-Glancy will be the last backbench speaker. Thank you.
Presiding Officer, I want to begin by thanking Paul Sweeney for bringing this important debate so timely and for the work that he has done so far. It has been an incredible campaign, and it's been an incredible campaign because of the amazing workforce that it is at McVitie's. And it has given us hope and motivation as politicians that we must win this fight. GMB, which I'm a member of, and I declare that, Presiding Officer, and Unite have left no stone unturned in the resources which they have applied to this campaign, working with Kate Forbes, who we'll hear from later on. I've worked with McVitie's over the last 5 years on various issues, and there were points where we felt changes to the production line signified a lack of commitment, but we were always given that assurance. But we did have a doubt in the back of our mind, it has to be said. As Paul Sweeney says, this has been the highest performing of all the UK sites. There is no reason on the face of it to select the Glasgow factory. Key performance indicators such as efficiency and maintenance, manufacturing, running on time, despite the fact it's probably up against it in terms of the investment that it clearly does need. I have to say to John Mason's contribution, I've spent a lot of time in this Parliament. I've been constituency MSP, I've been a regionalist MSP. There's just something in you, John, that just seems to be holding back as a constituency member. It seems to be giving up this fight too easily. The lines in McVitie's were adjusted to reduce sugar in the biscuits to accommodate, obviously, a concern for many factories that produce products with sugar in them. So I think that's a bit of a diversion. But the site also worked through the pandemic as an essential service, and we all as MSPs helped the workforce get through a difficult time, but they were there serving their community. And when the workforce was told that the plans to close the site, they were shocked and devastated at the news. And we know the ripples, the implications financially to Glasgow's East End and the Scottish economy are deeply concerning. And I welcome the fact that Kate Forbes and Susan Aitken got together very quickly to work on an alternative plan, and we must work together on it. I said from the beginning, when I addressed rallies, spoke to the workforce and in this chamber, directly to the First Minister, that I've always believed that her status as an international figure, which she is, was really instrumental in getting Plaidus to the table. And I know she has met with them. But I would, the Cabinet Secretary will appreciate the point that I'm making. And I think she's been dedicated to this fight. But I do think we've got something added here with our First Minister, and we need to make sure that she is going to fight with us to the death on this, because there is more to give from the government. And I think it's one of the central points that Paul Sweeney makes. There is more the Scottish Government can do and can give to make sure that Plaidus will not walk away from this site, because the offer is too good to refuse. Those are the terms we need to offer. I will continue to fight alongside the workforce, the unions, government ministers, my colleagues, John Mason, anyone who believes we cannot give up this fight on behalf of the workforce and the people of Glasgow and the west of Scotland and the industrial landscape that does not need the closure of McVitie's factory. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. And finally, I call Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to declare an interest as a member of the GMB Union. I'd like to congratulate Paul Sweeney, MSP, for bringing this debate today and to thank my colleagues in the Chamber, across the Chamber, as well as the GMB and Unite Trade Unions for all the tireless work that they have done so far to protect the jobs at McVitie's Tollcross site. I'd also like to express my ongoing solidarity to the workers at the Tollcross site and their families. Your fight is our fight, and we will be behind you every step of the way. Glasgow is a great city, which I'm incredibly proud to represent. The fact that it suffers from some of the worst poverty in Scotland is a tragedy and is not inevitable. Unemployment rates are rising more in Glasgow than other parts of the country. Almost half of Glasgow's residents live in deprived areas. Glasgow has consistently more people claiming out-of-work benefits than anywhere else in Scotland. And according to this government's own data, last year 34% of children in Glasgow were living in relative poverty. To make things worse, social security is being cut to the bone. An estimated 40% of Glasgow residents are set to see their benefits slashed by the upcoming changes to universal credit. And some of the worst affected areas, with more than half of families with children affected by the cut, are in three of our city's constituencies. On top of this, the council budget has been cut by 11% since 2014, despite the Scottish Government's funding having increased to that by more than 3%. These cuts to local councils by the government is equivalent to more than £1,500 per household. People in Glasgow can take no more. We must go hard and fast on poverty and inequality all across the UK. And when it comes to doing that, I'm afraid neither the UK nor the Scottish Government are hitting the mark. Against this backdrop of poverty and insecurity, the workers at the McVitie's factory in Tollcross have been told they are losing their jobs. That's 500 more workers and families facing uncertainty. 500 more workers and families at risk of being pulled into poverty. And 500 more workers and families that have been let down by the lack of safety net to protect people when they lose their jobs. Throughout this pandemic, the McVitie's Tollcross workers showed up day in, day out. Tollcross is the highest performing McVitie site, as we've already heard, with a dedicated and diligent workforce. They've given so much to this factory, and this is the thanks they get. The factory has stood in Tollcross for almost a century. Generations upon generations of Glaswegians have worked there, and there are cases where whole households work there together now. Many workers have said the factory is like a second family to them, with others describing the overwhelming feeling of devastation at the prospect of losing it. The factory is not just a workplace. It is central to their lives and the cornerstone of the community. To see Plaidis turn its back on its employees is appalling, yet another example of how the people of Glasgow are being disrespected. This assault on our jobs and our communities cannot be allowed to continue. The McVitie's workers deserve better. Glasgow deserves better. And the people of Glasgow want better. As of today, the Save Our Jobs petition has 77,456 signatures. A staggering number, speaking to the volume of overwhelming support the people of Glasgow are showing to the workers at Tollcross. And there's been displays of solidarity, like the rally in Tollcross Park and the tireless efforts of the GMB and Unite the Trade Unions to protect jobs. But the support for the McVitie's factory reaches beyond Glasgow too, because we know McVitie's story reaches beyond our city, with demonstrations outside M&S stores, for example, in Edinburgh and Dundee. The people of Scotland see this injustice and they demand action. It's not good enough to sit back and watch as 500 people lose their jobs. We have a responsibility to do everything possible in our power to prevent the closure of the site. There is a window of opportunity here, and it is vital that we grasp it and do absolutely everything we can. With the right funding and support, there is no reason why the factory needs to shut. And I welcome the efforts already made by the Scottish Government to try to save the Tollcross factory and protect jobs. But I echo the sentiments of my colleagues on these benches. The decision by Plaidis to reject the counter-proposal and continue with the plan to cease operations should not mean we give up and turn our backs on the workers. Instead, we need to now double down our efforts and not rest until we have exhausted every option. There are solutions available, whether it's capital funding or investment in machinery and resources. But should the worst-case scenario come to bear, the government must also continue to support the workforce, support them into new jobs without allowing anyone to slip into poverty, and use all of the powers it has on social security to support them to do that. The workers and their families deserve our support. The fight is not yet over, and we have your back. Now is the time to step up that fight for the future of McVitie's Tollcross factory. I urge everyone in this chamber, regardless of political party, join the fight and work together to save these jobs.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Clancy. I now call on Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary, to respond to the debate, and the Cabinet Secretary is joining us remotely. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I start by thanking Paul Sweeney for the debate and also welcome union representatives like Pat McElvogue to the Parliament today. Presiding Officer, as we've heard from members this afternoon, the importance of McVitie's Tollcross called for robust cross-party collaboration and a very strong partnership with trade unions in order to save the factory. And I believe that over the last few months, we have all risen to the challenge since the announcement by Plaidis. And I'd like to thank the trade unions in particular. They work tirelessly to represent their members, even in the face of constant hurdles. And I'd also like to pay tribute to local representatives, particularly David Linden, for all he's done to engage the UK government in this fight. Can I also say just how disappointed I am not to be in the chamber today, unexpectedly due to my contact with a COVID positive case in the family. Nevertheless, I hope that I can speak robustly for the workers. And Presiding Officer, I know it's perhaps not the done thing, but I know it's not possible to take interventions when speaking remotely. So I wonder if you would allow me to pause during my speech later on to take any questions or interventions from members who would have wanted to intervene. So if I pause, and perhaps you could call on anybody who stands up. The announcement by Plaidis in May that it planned to close its site in Tollcross with the loss of almost 500 jobs was, as other members have articulated, a devastating blow for the workers directly affected, but also for the local area and indeed for our country, because the implications of this decision will have a ripple effect, not just on the workers themselves who have been through a hugely stressful period, but also on supply chains and on others whose work relies indirectly on that factory. Paul Sweeney and others have rightly pointed out that this is a site with a very rich history in the east end of Glasgow, having been established almost 100 years ago. And in addition to the direct effect on those employed, the loss of this brand to Scotland is also one that is very difficult to accept. And that's why, from the very beginning, my priority is and always has been the workforce at the site, and I have ensured that the Scottish Government and others have taken every action possible when it comes to Plaidis. We moved very quickly at the outset to respond to the news with a collaborative partnership approach. We obviously immediately established the action group, and I have chaired that action group alongside the leader of Glasgow City Council. The action group's membership includes the Scottish Government, Glasgow City Council, a number of public sector partners like Scottish Enterprise, and as well as that, GMB and Unite, and representatives of the non-unionised staff are also members of the action group. And they have made contributions that have been invaluable and have represented their workforce admirably throughout that very challenging process. I would have liked, and I think all of us would have liked, to have had representation from Plaidis itself on the action group. It would have given the group an opportunity to understand the company's thinking at first hand, and also allowed us to put direct questions to management on their rationale. Most importantly, it would have allowed us to use all the evidence and all the data to build the best possible counter proposal. I wrote numerous times to Plaidis's managing director, inviting him to attend the action group, but to date, every single one of those invitations have been declined. So instead, we worked closely with the unions, offering advice and support as they developed the counter-proposal, which they presented to Plaidis on the 27th of July. We enlisted the help of external commercial advisers to support and assist the unions in the development of that proposal. And as others have said, it was a well-formed, compelling proposal. It took a lot of effort. And that makes it all the more disappointing that just 2 weeks after it was presented to the company, Plaid has rejected it and announced its decision to proceed with closure. What's doubly hard to take, I think, for workers, unions and the action group is that that disappointment is compounded by the fact that the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister met with Plaid's global chief executive on July 29th. He gave very firm assurances that there would be full consideration and engagement around the proposal. And both I and the First Minister have written separately to Plaid's after their decision to remind the company of that commitment and ask that they honour it. Presiding Officer, at this time of difficulty, I want the members of the Parliament and I want the workers to know this, that we have worked tirelessly to save this factory and we will not give up. Richard Leonard said that we should not walk away. We have not. We have constantly, continually and unrelentingly pursued this. Richard Leonard said that ministers should understand the anger of the workforce. I understand it because I've been speaking to the workers. That we should not send in the PACE team. We won't. We have established the action group to look at all alternatives to closure. And the evidence for my speech this afternoon is in every step we've taken over the last few months, every meeting we've had with Plaid's where robust words have been exchanged, and every action that all of us have taken. We were prepared to engage with Plaid's on how best to progress a commercial proposal. But before discussions had begun, Plaid has confirmed their intentions. Our aim was always to present the most compelling case, and we will continue to work together to try to secure the best possible outcome. We stand prepared to continue to engage with Plaid's on how we can help to maintain a presence in Scotland. Presiding Officer, before I see if there's any interventions, I want to touch on a point that's been raised by a number of members, because in order to continue to provide support, we do need assurances, and trade unions, I think, are agreed on this. We need assurances and commitments from Plaid's that it is committed to Scotland, that it will remain in Scotland, and it will continue to provide employment for the longer term. And so I want to pick up on Paul Sweeney's question about finance and be clear that the First Minister and I have been absolutely transparent and open that we are willing to provide support. We are willing to provide some financial support if it means that Plaid's will keep the factory open. We have articulated that position in letters as well as in face-to-face conversations, albeit virtually. What's not helpful to the workers or to the negotiations is to offer a blank cheque without firm commitments that Plaid's will keep that factory open. And the fear, of course, is that whatever we offer will always be too low for a company that is determined to shut down that factory. My last letter to Plaid's in the last few weeks, and the First Minister's last letter to Plaid's also in the last week or so, asked a very clear question. What value would be enough to keep you in Scotland? If what we've offered so far isn't enough, what will it take to keep the factory open? The answers to those letters, one of which I have received, has still not answered that question. And, Presiding Officer, I know it's not the done thing, but I would be happy to take any interventions at this point.
Cabinet Secretary, can I perhaps respond to that offer to say that I'm sure it is very much appreciated that there's a willingness to engage in that way in this debate, because of course you are currently self-isolating and that is why you're not in the chamber. However, I have been advised by the senior clerk that particularly from a technical perspective, the technical platform available simply would not allow meaningful engagement in that way at this time. So I would suggest that, of course, if members wish to take up the Cabinet Secretary's offer during the debate, they will find the means to do that. I'm quite confident by correspondence, by email, by oral written question, or indeed any other means. So I think we would have to leave that matter there, Cabinet Secretary, and I would ask if you would now proceed to bring your remarks to a conclusion. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's always worth trying to be pioneering at the very least. So as I do draw to close, I'm very happy to continue these conversations and discussions with members separately to this debate. And I'm not somebody who likes to give up. I'm absolutely adamant that the Tollcross factory is vitally important, not just locally, not just to each of those workers, but also nationally. And we will continue to work to try and secure a future for Plaidis and its staff here in Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes this debate. And I suspend the proceedings until 2:30 this afternoon. Thank you.